Appreciate it, man. So there is clearly, as Chris lays out, there is a lot to look at here and more. So let's do that. Let's do that with CNN's team that has logged countless, I tried to count, I'm kidding, I did not, countless hours reporting on this investigation, broke stories on every twist and turn, sat outside courthouses, townhouses, special counsel's offices for months. In totality, we could not fit them all in the room, I will say.
You know, Gloria sat outside the special
counsel's office. Yeah, right, never.
Every morning. Hours. Yeah.
These are hours we will never get back, by the way.
Right now.
And Pamela, so many times, you all the stories detailing parts of the investigation, detailing some of the things that we read, you know, in detail and in testimony in the Mueller report. And the president over and over again, and his office over and over again throughout this, had called it fake news and denied things. And so I think one thing that we definitely learned from this report is, by and large, the reporting has bared out. Mm-hmm. And I wonder now, what do you do the next time the president denies a story?
Well, ignore him like we have been. Yeah. I mean, that's just par for the course. Mueller did, and his team, was piece it all together and show a pattern of behavior by the president and a motive of why he was trying to, you know, obstruct.
Yes, go ahead.
The thing is, you also can see that, you know, I don't think this is going to happen, right? No one does. Won't, but they should be.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because Mueller explicitly stated that because of the power in his office, being the president, that his public statements hold weight, particularly as they were
trying to say, even about tweets from day one. It's different when it's coming from the president of the United States.
It's all archived.
Kara, Monty was laying out that Jerry Nadler's not satisfied, right? He wants to see the full unredacted report. The redactions equal out to what? Some, in totality, probably about 36 pages. It would be maybe 8% of what we are looking at. Can you guys, have you been able to glean or learn anything from the redactions, the context the redactions could offer?
Yeah, I mean, Caroline Kelly, one of our only two cases.
The big, 12. Michael Cohen Michael is the big
Cohen.
One.
Michael Cohen, and there are 12 that we don't know.
The thing that you did a lot of reporting on was on the conversations, the back and forth about will he, won't he sit down for an in-person interview, the president with the special counsel. I am still stuck this morning, and I've read through the special counsel's reasoning, maybe the shortest thing you could read. Why they didn't pursue the subpoena. I'm still stuck on it.
Well, first of all, trying to decipher these conversations before the election. And also, he said, it was sort of interesting. He said, kind of, if you were to go to get a subpoena, and a
case right. We're in the bar.
The other thing that I've always thought about, if the president is the target, he is the target of this obstruction investigation, how creating an entire
this picture of sympathetic figure who was just fighting back on an investigation he believed was a hoax. So I think there are definitely competing views of.
Thanks so much.
Thanks for being here.
What are we going to do now?
Yeah.
I will, I'm sure we. Forget President Trump. Pardon me. Forget President. President Trump isn't the only person facing real and renewed scrutiny today following the redacted report's release. Attorney General. What's your take now, Ellie, from a prosecutor's perspective, on Bill Barr, from the four-page memo to the press conference yesterday, and then comparing that now to the redacted report?
I think Bill Barr's credibility and independence are in the trash. I really think he's a specific reason, because the memo, the DOJ policy said you cannot.
There's something in between Barr doing political spin as an appointee of the president and an honest difference of opinion on legal analysis.
Well, there would be, but I don't think that'd be repudiated Barr's analysis.
Let's get to that, actually, because there are a few. I want to go to, if I can get to some areas of legal language to have you guys decipher. This one on the special counsel on obstruction of justice. Here is what they write. If we had copy laying it out this way.
Wait, it's like a triple negative. He says, well, if he was clear, we would tell you.
Jump ahead just for the control room to the one, an interesting footnote, Shan, that I have. That I wanted to get to, because footnotes is where all the interesting stuff comes out. And here's what it says. A possible remedy through impeachment. Didn't have to say that at all.
Right.
Like, he didn't have to leave. He didn't have to put that in.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Coming up for us still, the heated debate among Democrats. Game over. That's President Trump's message now to Democrats after the release of the redacted Mueller report. Again, what do Democrats do now? I think that is maybe the other than exactly what do you think happened in the report and how is the White House
ability as the majority, you know, party in the House.
But I do wonder if there is a roadmap that they've set on kind of like the steps forward for the Democratic caucus, because you see a split in already the language in Congress. So other than that step, I mean, I don't, with that step, I do wonder if that would change any opinion to lead anyone to a more bipartisan move towards impeachment. I do wonder if she has taken any steps to lay out a roadmap for Democrats on what they should do here.
Maxine Waters, let these cheermen and cheerwomen of the House of Representatives
report on Russia and the Russia investigation. I do wonder what more partisan elected officials are going to uncover. Tax returns kind of is maybe the exception that Mueller hasn't already uncovered, but we will see where it goes. It's good talking about Speaker Pelosi. Speaker Pelosi also says that